Mubarak is the one that has fed movies like The Protocols every year during Ramadan in order to brainwash and to facilitate this type of antagonism. The more we think that the Brotherhood takes over, the more he can legitimately say that, well, I have to do this in order to keep my Brotherhood people at bay. And I think you'll find
that's why I said that there are no
hold on, guys, gentlemen. Mr. Scheuer, is an Obama backing of a Mubarak government a sign to the people of Egypt or maybe even the people of the Middle East that we're still firmly implanted on the side of Israel?
Oh, sure it is, sir. Yeah. Israel is such an enormous detriment to the United States, our relationship with the Israelis, that it's going to become clear to Americans that this is just going to cost us blood and lives the longer we pursue this relationship with the Israelis.
Mr. Spencer, you're laughing. You disagree?
Well, I think that's appallingly a terrible thing for Mr. Scheuer to have said. Israel is the only real democracy. You know, Mr. Jasser wants democracy. Israel's the only democracy in the Middle East. It's the only stable government. It's the only one that protects human rights. And Mr. Scheuer wants us to throw it under the bus for a bunch of people who are going to institute a system of Islamic law that institutionalizes discrimination against non-Muslims and women, extinguishes the freedom of speech and the freedom of conscience, and is inveterately hostile to Israel to a genocidal degree.
Mr. Jasser, democracy at any cost. It doesn't matter who they put in as long as they put someone in because they want it, because they're lighting fires in the street. Is that what you're saying?
No, Eric. Change does not happen easily. These guys are not going to leave. The population has not been educated to the point of understanding Jeffersonian principles. If we're going to help them, we need to start building institutions, to being on the ground, not
time,
just abandoning
sir.
Them.
All due respect, well, we don't have time.
That's
there are
the
people
thing.
In the streets who may be dying right now. Do we have time to go through the whole process?
But Eric,
do we or not?
That's the issue, is the American ADD problem, where we only pay attention for 2 weeks and then we abandon them. That has to change. The long-term stability is what we need to look at, and I think that's
great
what will be in Israel's interest and America's interest and everybody's.
Great discussion. We'll be on it. I'm sure there's going to be a lot more, Mr. Jasser, Mr. Spencer, and Mr. Scheuer. Appreciate your time, fellas.
Thank you, sir.
All right, back at home, people are wondering, what about oil prices? At this moment, President Obama is scheduled to be in a closed-door meeting on U.S. energy policy. How important is Egypt to U.S. oil interest? I'm going to show you that, plus commodity prices are poised to skyrocket. Next. From Fox News reporters on the ground, the rounds are going over the heads of protesters, but they're in the direct line of fire. Here at home, how important is Egypt to U.S. oil interest? Take a look at this map of oil choke points. Within a mere few hundred miles, one-third of all the oil on the planet is produced. It travels through. There's the Suez Canal. You can see that, either the canal or the pipeline. Here's the big one. On the other side of Saudi Arabia, the Persian Gulf, the Strait of Hormuz handles 20 million barrels of oil a day. Very important point. Are you scared? I'm scared. Disrupt even one barrel of oil flow, and prices at the pump, the grocery store, the mall, and your home will skyrocket. With me now, John Hofmeister. He's the former head of Shell Oil. And Steve Moore is a senior economic writer at the Wall Street Journal. Hofmeister, I'm going to start with you, my friend. You've been it. You've been the CEO of Shell. You know how important that Middle Eastern, those two choke points, the Suez Canal and the Strait of Hormuz. You tell us, tell our viewer how important that area is. And by the way, how important keeping flow of oil through there is.
We've known for decades how vulnerable we are, Eric, to these choke points. And there have been all kinds of scenarios and games played out in terms of what might happen. We use as a world 85 million barrels a day. The United States uses 20 million barrels a day, every day, 10,000 gallons a second. And we're shutting down drilling in our own Gulf of Mexico. This is absurd. It is absurd that a nation that has so much demand.
John, what if we were to choke off one of those two, the Persian Gulf, the Strait of Hormuz? By the way, on the other side of Saudi Arabia, on that choke point lies Iran. If Iran were to get a crazy idea and close that port, close that shipping lane, what would happen to the price of oil and gas?
It would only take a matter of hours before we would see significant movement, days before we could see the price of oil go up 50% or even double. Because the amount of oil coming
You're saying $200 a barrel.
It could easily get to $200 a barrel if after several days there's no sign of a let up in the crunch point.
Okay, Steve, if I have Steve Moore, I hope I have him. There we go, Steve. Okay, since you saw the pictures in Egypt, you see the protesters in the street. Since we started seeing those last Thursday or Friday when it escalated, the price of gasoline, not at the pump, not the AAA number that everyone reads, the price of gasoline on the wholesale level has jumped 13 cents a gallon. What does that mean to American consumers?
Well, Eric, first of all, that's nothing. I mean, 13 cents is a lot, but if these projections are right that John is talking about, we're looking at, you know, the price of gasoline. I just filled up yesterday. I think I paid something around $3.59 a gallon, which is a lot. But we could see the price of gasoline, if we moved to $150 or $200 a barrel oil, we could be looking at $5 a gallon
and Steve,
to fill up.
You
so that
there?
Would be a huge increase. And that is really dependent on whether or not we can get this oil out of the Persian Gulf.
Right. We can talk oil ad nauseum, but here's what matters. Here's what matters. When the price of oil goes up, Steve, what happens to the price of food? What happens to the price of corn? What happens to the price of wheat, a box of cereal? How about cotton, the jeans we wear,
right,
the shirts we wear? What happens to those prices?
They all go up, Eric. That's one of the lessons we learned back. Remember, we had the big spike in oil prices back a few years ago, and those of us who are old enough to remember the 1970s remember that as the oil price spiked up, we saw price increases for everything from copper to wheat to Wheaties on the grocery store shelf. So this is a potentially inflationary effect, and I think John makes a very important point. Why is it that we are not developing our own oil and natural gas resources? I mean, this is another one of those times to wonder how it's in our economic or national security sense not to be developing our own oil.
So, John, let me throw this at you. July 14th of 2008, the highest price oil ever traded, $147.25. 2 days later, President Bush removed the moratorium on offshore drilling. That was the top. Within 6 months, oil went to $33 immediately. But the thought of being able to drill more, what would that do to the price of oil? Would it matter if people were fist pumping in the street in Cairo?
Oil is a psychological price as well as a material price. And it's the expectation of the future which drives the price. If the U.S. said, we're going back to 10 million barrels a day of production, where we were in the 1970s, all the oil markets would be calmed down immediately, overnight. Now, we wouldn't get 10 million barrels for a number of years, but it's just the psychology of knowing that the U.S. will start taking better care of its own demand so it doesn't put so much pressure on global demand.
Hey, Steve,
there's a lot of countries out there don't have oil, and they need for the U.S. to be producing its own oil.
Steve, there's a great case study in this. Every business school teacher, I've said this before, every business school professor in America should say, the case for drilling is this. Since the protesting in the streets, since you saw the Molotov cocktails, the bombs, the rocks being thrown, the price of oil has shot up, skyrocketed, gasoline skyrocketing, but natural gas has gone down. Now there's a reason for that, Steve. Why is that?
Well, first of all, this should be a wake-up call, Eric. I mean, I'm so glad we're talking about this because, as I said, this is such an important national security issue. Now, here's the point about natural gas, which is really, I think, the silver lining in all of this, Eric. It turns out the United States is becoming the Saudi Arabia of natural gas. Every time you turn around, we're finding new procedures to get natural gas and new sources of natural gas in the continental United States. But, Eric, what is happening right now as we speak is the Environmental Protection Agency and the Interior Department are preventing the mining and the exploration and the excavation of that natural gas, which could keep prices extremely low for American consumers and mean that the price of pumping gas for your car or heating your home would be going down significantly.
So, Hoffmeister, my point was, it didn't matter if there's protesting in the street, if it affects the price of gas and oil if there is. It didn't matter to natural gas with the protesting because we produce the natural gas that we use right
That's
here
right.
in America. Isn't that a case for drilling our own oil, not natural gas, but oil?
Both. Our natural gas, absolutely, because that will lower the price of electricity to the economy that depends on electricity. But don't forget, the high price of crude oil will completely melt down any economic recovery. The disposable income that is lost to higher gas prices goes away. It takes away the consumer power to buy whatever else they need. And the whole economy could sink with the kind of crude oil price spike that we could be looking
at. And Steve Moore, in the 13 or 14 cents that gasoline has run up on the wholesale level in the last few days since the ride it has been going on, that's like a tax to the American consumer. But the problem is it's not a tax collected by our government. to build a road or a bridge or something. It's a tax collected in the end by a foreign government that, frankly, wants to kill us.
Eric, I like that description. I use that description myself. Anytime the price of oil or natural gas or the price of heating your home goes up, this is like a tax on American consumers. And what it means is that our living standards go down and our ability to buy other things is basically squeezed out by these high energy prices. That's what we learned in the 1970s when we had the oil crises back then. And I go back to this point that we have the capability here in the United States to become less dependent on these unstable places in the Middle East where we get so much of the oil, and yet we're taking no steps. In fact, this administration is taking steps to prevent us from tapping our own resources.
And Hoffmeister, I thought everything was going to be okay if we just rolled out an electric car.
You got 250 million cars on the road that only use gas. A million electric cars by 2015, if it's possible. So what? How about the 250 million that only use gasoline or diesel?
We have some
awful leadership of what is of the energy sector right now.
And very quickly,
we're not doing,
Steve,
what is good for the country.
Yeah. And very quickly, Steve.
And, you know, there's an important point. Can I add one?
Go ahead.
Let me just add one point on this. That look, even if we go to electric cars, Eric, and who knows what the future holds, but we're going to need electric power to generate the battery power.
Right.
And you're not going to have cars running on windmills and solar paneling.
Right.
We're going to need natural gas even if we go to those electric cars.
All right, we're going to have to leave it there, Steve Moore and John Hoffmeister. Appreciate your guys' time. Thank you very much. Next, the latest on the vote to repeal health care, Obamacare. How could your coverage be affected? That's coming up.